Well, welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming. I'm David Blight. I direct the Gilder Lehrman Center for the Study of Slavery, Resistance, and Abolition. This is a panel born, of course, of the event of the third week of June in Charleston and its aftermath. I'm going to introduce our panel in just a few minutes. And each of them is going to, they were told they have 3 minutes for an opening statement, which, you know, with academics means they're going to try to take more. And I'm going to try to prevent them, and they'll all stay under four, or thereabout, I hope. Anyway, but by way of introduction, we all live in the present, of course. But sometimes, as we all know, the past somehow seems to explode in the present. And sometimes there are events that absolutely no one predicts or can even surmise. And those events that might happen in only a day or an hour can illuminate a century or a century and a half in this case. When Dylan Roof went into Emanuel AME Church on June 17th, he went to the heart of African-American history. What President Obama, in his extraordinary eulogy for Reverend Clementa Pinckney, called our beating heart, and by that he meant black people's beating heart, the place where our dignity as a people is inviolate, or at least it was supposed to be inviolate. Now, Emanuel AME, as some of you probably know, is at 110 Calhoun Street. There, I put the name in the air. This panel is not about Calhoun College, although I'm sure it may come up. It's at 110 Calhoun Street, which is approximately 3 blocks from Francis Marion Park, which has the giant 80-some foot tall statue or monument to John C. Calhoun. It's a particularly poignant historical juxtaposition in Charleston, and always has been, never quite so much as it was in June. 2 months before the murders, I had the now incredible experience. It was incredible at the time, but I was with Reverend Pinckney on the same little platform in a park in Charleston called Hampton Park. We were there in April to commemorate the 150th anniversary of the first Memorial Day, founded there by African Americans at the end of the Civil War on May 1st, 1865. It was an extraordinary ceremony. The Citadel Choir sang. The Citadel is located right next to Hampton Park, named for Wade Hampton, the white supremacist redeemer governor of South Carolina after Reconstruction. And my job was just to tell the story of that first Memorial Day, and the main event was Reverend Pinckney, who delivered a beautiful 11-minute homily rooted in 2 Samuel, the story of King David and his son Absalom. Absalom, O Absalom, my son, that famous passage, which is born of that terrible, horrible reality in the Old Testament story of Absalom fighting in war against his father, King David, killing his own brother, and then being killed in war fighting against his father. Reverend Pinckney used that metaphor of civil war to then unfold a story about America's civil war. He went to the most ancient stories of civil war. And of course, he did what a preacher would do. He folded that then into a story of reconciliation of North and South, of black and white, and of South Carolina. And he's a South Carolinian. He was a South Carolinian. And that man, though only 41, had really learned how to navigate Civil War memory in the state of South Carolina. That ceremony ended with Reverend Pinckney and me holding a program together, because we only had one, singing America the Beautiful, as well as about 2 other hymns. And when the murders occurred in Charleston that night, I didn't even immediately remember that that had been Reverend Pinckney I mean, I wasn't hearing the names yet, and then suddenly I heard the news, and I thought, oh my God, that was Pinckney. And of course, what followed is what we're here to discuss. All over the United States, and for that matter, the world, everyone was talking about what did Charleston mean, and would the flag come down? And anyone who works in this field or is on that list of what some of us on this panel know as the 1-800 dial memory list got endless requests from the media to talk about the flag, the flag, the flag, from all corners of the world. They all had to do their 5 minutes on the Confederate flag. They all had to ask, why are you Americans still doing this? I got into a real row with a guy in Spain who wrote for El País. And I got my American nationalism up at one point, and I just told him, well, what about your Civil War? You haven't solved yours either, and that's kind of where we ended it. But right now, as many of you know, in city after city, controversies have erupted. New Orleans is having one about what to do with Lee's Circle. Charlottesville, Virginia is having one about what to do with the Lee and Stonewall Jackson monuments in its center. Just today, I got an email from someone in St. Louis who wants a consultation about whether the new petition to the city council about the big Confederate monument in Forest Park in St. Louis, and this goes on and on and on. Nashville's having a big row over Nathan Bedford Forrest, as is Memphis, et cetera. Washington and Lee University is having a very serious, they've been having it even before Charleston, about taking, in fact, they have a long petition, apparently, from some of their law school students to take the name Lee off Washington and Lee. You know, never say never anymore, but that one I can't believe is really going to happen, but never say never. Even Bubba Watson, the golfer, apparently took the Confederate flag off his Dukes of Hazzard car. Isn't that great to know? But everywhere, license plates, the flag, came down, and none of us, and this is something I want to hear Edward say something about, none of us probably believed we'd ever see that. So the first question I want this panel to address in one way or another, and they will in their own ways, and perhaps you will with us in Q&A, is why did it take a mass murder in a black church to get the Confederate flag off of official sites? Why is that? Okay, I want to quickly as I can, introduce this panel, and I hope Jelani shows in the meantime. I think I'll just go in the order that they are sitting. Some on this panel need very little introduction, for students in particular, but they'll get them anyway. Jonathan Holloway is, of course, Dean of Yale College. He's a graduate of Yale. Former master of Calhoun College for 8 or 9 years, and an expert on that problem. We have the other master of Calhoun in here too, Julia Adams, who's now an expert on that problem too, indeed, and don't you love it? Anyway, Jonathan is a superb historian, and now particularly of matters of memory. His first book was Confronting the Veil, a study of three major African-American social scientists. His second book, called Jim Crow Wisdom, Memory and Identity in Black America Since 1940, is both a historical analysis of black community memory since 1940, but also a kind of personal memoir. And he's also editor of numerous things, including, most recently, a new edition of Du Bois' Souls of Black Folk. Glenda Gilmore, my colleague in the history department in AFAM, is the C. Van Woodward Professor of History at Yale. She's written numerous books, Defying Dixie, The Radical Roots of Civil Rights from 1919 to 1950. Before that, Gender and Jim Crow, Women and Politics and the Politics of White Supremacy in North Carolina, which was a multiple prize-winning book. She has a brand new book coming out, I think, almost any time, co-authored with Tom Segrew, called These United States, A Nation in the Making, 1890 to the Present. And I know she's also working on a book on Romare Bearden. And I must say, too, that everyone on this panel, in one way or another, wrote something about what happened in Charleston. Jonathan, in his address to the freshmen, which some of you may have heard, I heard it, he was less addressing the events in Charleston as Yale's problems with names, but born certainly of the problems in Charleston. Glenda wrote a marvelous piece in the History News Network, which we may refer to in a moment. Edward Ball, an old friend. Edward lives here in New Haven, though this year he is at the Cullman Center for Writers and Scholars at the New York Public Library, which is Shangri-La for writers, trust me. And it was not easy to get him to take a day off from that wonderful little retreat for writers. Edward's a nonfiction writer of great distinction, and he was born in Savannah, grew up in both Louisiana and South Carolina, and in particular grew up in Charleston. And it was those roots in Charleston that were the source of his most famous book, Slaves in the Family, published in 1998, the study of his own slaveholding ancestors and 10 black families that his ancestors owned. It was a New York Times bestseller, won the National Book Award, et cetera, et cetera. He's also the author of numerous other nonfiction works, The Sweet Hell Inside, which is the story of an African-American family that rose from the ashes of the Civil War to become musicians, Peninsula of Lies, the life of an English writer named Gordon Hall, one of the first sex reassignment patients, the book The Genetic Strand, a case study of the process of using DNA to investigate family history, and most recently, the book called The Inventor and the Tycoon, which is a study of Edward Muybridge, or the story of Edward Muybridge and the origin of motion pictures. He's now writing what was originally going to be a novel, but he's sticking to nonfiction, about his ancestor in the Ku Klux Klan. Edward knows a few things about Charleston and its problems, and also published a piece right after Charleston about the flag in Reuters, I believe it was. And then Vesla Weaver, my colleague in FM and also in the Yale Political Science Department, she did her PhD at Harvard. She studies racial inequality in numerous ways. She's the author with Amy Lerman of the book Arresting Citizenship, The Democratic Consequences of American Crime Control. She's also the author of what I think is forthcoming, but it may be out, you have to tell me, a book called, oh no, it's under contract, I guess, which can mean a lot of things, but anyway. It's called Frontlash, Civil Rights, the Carceral State, and the Transformation of American Politics. Vesla teaches about racial inequality, the politics of racial inequality in the United States. I'll quickly introduce Jelani, because he may just be dancing in the side door, and I wouldn't want to stop in the middle of anything. Jelani Cobb, as many of you know, is a major writer for The New Yorker magazine, but in his day job, he's a professor of American history and Africana studies. African-American studies at UConn in Storrs. He's the author of numerous books, The Substance of Hope, Barack Obama and the Paradox of Progress, To the Break of Dawn, a Freestyle on the Hip-Hop Aesthetic, a book of essays called The Devil and Dave Chappelle and Other Essays, and he's also the editor of the Essential Harold Cruz, a reader. Jelani writes for all kinds of public journals, magazines, and some of you may indeed follow his pieces in The New Yorker. He's had at least 3 pieces in The New Yorker in one way or another, inspired by, influenced by what happened in Charleston. He's also the author of one of the 4 chapters of the companion history that will come out with the new African American Museum in Washington. I'm proud to say he's a colleague on that. I'm writing one of those too, if we ever get them done. Anyway, that's our panel, and I'm going to turn it now first. Let's just go in the order you're sitting. Jonathan, why don't you go first? Everyone's going to get an opening statement on this. I asked them to just think about this question of what Charleston meant, and now in its aftermath, 3 months hence, 3 minutes. Jonathan.
I will not take 3 minutes.
Oh, Glenda, you get 1 minute.
I am teaching my, good afternoon, thanks for being here. This semester, I am teaching my introductory survey course, African American History, Emancipation to the Present. And as I tell the students, there are going to be numerous moments in the class. There'll be numerous moments in the class where today's headlines will resonate with things that might leave them asking, didn't we take care of that 80 years ago? Wasn't this something that you talked about from 120 years ago? I say this because the past is always with us in all kinds of ways. And I want to just focus that. There'll be the phenomenon of potential stepping on each other's toes. I'll be very quick and can fill in later on. My comments are trained around the idea of things that we think are new that are actually quite old. Ferguson, Cleveland, New York, South Carolina, different places. I mean, these are not new. They're just newly to our attention based upon the technologies that we carry in our pockets, certainly. But I want to reference in particular Dylann Roof's, I don't know what you would call, rantings that express not anything new, but an old story of white pathological obsession with black male desire. And these are key words. Some of these, if you're in my class, you'll have known this already. A famous poster, What Miscegenation Is. I mean, the historians up here will know this reference, just that phrase. Now that Mr. Lincoln is reelected with a black man and white woman in an embrace, the fear of that poster reflected of Lincoln's reelection, what that meant to propriety. Welcome, sir. We just started.
I just introduced you. You got great time.
So let me, while Jelani's getting settled here, a poster called What Miscegenation Is, going back to the 1860s, in today's class, I showed clips from Birth of a Nation, the movie that is shot through with a psychosis, one might say, of white male obsession, of black male desire. E. Franklin Frazier, the sociologist who early in his career, I think this is around 1925, had to leave Atlanta as a lynch mob was coming after him when they realized he was the author of an article talking about white male pathological desire for black females. That's what's really happening when they talk about the black male threat and desire for white women. I could go on and on with different examples. I'll bring it to more recent, although it's fading with time, I suppose. The national fascination with O.J. Simpson. Black male desire. White woman on a pedestal. The objects of consumption, of preservation, and of heritage. And I'll just close on this one phrase, heritage, because it's going back to your charge, David, about the flag itself. Whose heritage? The heritage of black male desire? The heritage of white male desire? The phantasmagoria of desire that is displaced into political systems? Whose heritage?
Glenda, go ahead. Everyone's taken their 3 minutes.
Okay. I've never even answered the phone in under 4 minutes. So. It was not a symbol of the old South that white politicians abandoned after Charleston. It was the white new South's century-old political formula. Suddenly, after the Charleston massacre, elected officials scrambled to remove the Confederate flag. This startling turnaround reflects not regret, rather their political ambitions, and proves that they always understood the flag's power. The Confederate flag symbolizes not Southern heritage, but a malleable white supremacy that politicians have used to solidify generations of white voters across class lines. Their willingness to discard it now demonstrates the fact that they no longer need it to control working class white Southern voters who now have few choices left. The Confederate flag did heavy lifting during two historical watersheds, the 1890s campaigns to disenfranchise black voters and the 1950s white massive resistance campaigns to the civil rights movement. In 1890, Mississippi disfranchised voters aimed to disfranchise black voters. And in 1894, Mississippi adopted the Confederate flag as their state flag. In the 1890s, as Jonathan mentioned, white elites, including South Carolina's red shirts, convinced poor white men who were voting for the Populist Party along with black voters that black voting and black office holding inspired black men to rape white women. This sounds like quite a jump for us, but it was quite close, partly because of the miscegenation discussions during Reconstruction. In other words, civil rights produces black rapists. In the 1950s, massive white resistance spread the sameness of black rapists, this time in the schools, and Confederate flags represented white supremacy to a new generation. South Carolina adopted the Confederate flag to fly above its capital in 1962. The white conservative South, represented by the flag, was also a key to the new right's national rise to power. South Carolinian Lee Atwater, strategist to Ronald Reagan and later George H.W. Bush, put it this way, quote, "You start out in 1954 crying nigger, 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 and by 1968, you're talking about cutting taxes." The Confederate flag as a symbol linked racism, hypermilitarism, and anti-immigrant policies. Dylann Roof bought the century-old racist story that the flag told. He told his victims, quote, "I have to do it. You rape our women, and you're taking over our country, and you have to go." The absurdity of telling six middle-aged and elderly church ladies, "You rape our women," escaped him. Our country, to Roof, excluded black people named Middleton, Pinckney, and Singleton. South Carolina names older than our country itself. By saying you've got to go, Roof declared a race war. Citizens across the country and around the world quickly substituted the words terrorist and terrorism for hate crime and mentally deranged guy with a gun to describe the Charleston massacre. Roof joined jihadists around the world and thus presented a problem for Southern white leaders in a so-called post-racial world. That is why South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham, who originally said, quote, "We're not going to give this guy an excuse about a symbol, it's him, not the flag," reversed himself within 72 hours. Because of South Carolina's economic austerity, Ruth, a 10th grade dropout in a state where one in four students fails, white students fails to complete high school, faced a life of dead end, insecure jobs without the social safety net that might have helped him with his drug problem. All that was left to him was the Confederate flag, which represented, or so he had been led to believe, the values that he shared with elite white Southern elected officials. Eager to take charge of the campaign against international terrorism, white conservatives suddenly realized that the flag is an outmoded tool for controlling those poor white voters. The newest New South, they bargained, can propagate, quote, our Southern values and racist politics without it.
Edward. Thank you, Glenda.
Thank you, David. Thanks for the invitation. It's good to see you all. I was born in Savannah, Georgia, about 100 miles south of Charleston. But when I was a child, my parents moved our family to Charleston. It's the hometown of my dad and his family. 300 years living there in the same place. And today I have about 150 cousins living there within a radius of 25 miles. We moved away when I was still a boy, and I grew up in my teens in New Orleans, Louisiana. So these are the two hometowns that I claim, Charleston and New Orleans. I knew parishioners of Emanuel AME, and I do know parishioners there, and I've been to services in that church, funerals. The city of Charleston, for most Americans, is an obscure, beautiful, and provincial place. It's a place where people go to get married, go to look at old houses, go to eat shrimp and grits, sometimes exactly in that order. 5 million tourists a year, give or take, but the hidden history of Charleston, hidden in plain sight, makes it more important than the numbers. Population 200,000, including the suburbs, 35% black, 60% white, a small Latino population. Used to be, until World War II, a majority black state, South Carolina did. And to enter South Carolina was to go into a black society. Interestingly, a lot of South Carolinians came this way during the Great Migration, and New Haven is full of black families from Charleston and the Carolinas. A lot of people who run this university, who staff the secretarial desks, who run the dining halls and the physical plant are from South Carolina. You only have to listen and you will hear a gullah melody in campus hallways and along every sidewalk. Mm. It would be interesting to hear from some of them too. Charleston is the city that everyone knows started the Civil War. It's the city that normalized white supremacy. It provided the ideology of states' rights in the person of John C. Calhoun. It provided the ideology of white supremacy, which was, in my opinion, from that place exported to the rest of the country. It is the city that was the Jerusalem of slavery, the place where slavery really caught, the place where the structures formed by slavery, the caste system, were brought into focus and from which they were exported to the rest of the country. It's the city that, if you were to be enslaved in the United States, the first place where you would have set foot. 40% of black people living today in the United States have ancestors who arrived in Charleston from West Africa, which is the number that compares favorably with Ellis Island. 40% of white Americans have ancestors who set foot in the U.S. at Ellis Island. However, the home place of the killer, Dylan Roof, is upstate. His home county, Lexington County, along with neighboring Lawrence County and Anderson County, have the distinction of being the birthplace of the Ku Klux Klan in this part of the South. 145 years ago, the white militia, made up of angry young men, veterans of the Civil War. Those counties have the distinction of hosting the very first Klan prosecutions staged by the federal government in 1871, when Washington, D.C. tried for a couple of years anyway to put white supremacy out of its misery. Domestic terrorism was born and raised in those counties. During the Klan trials of 1871 in central South Carolina, witnesses repeated the words of Klansmen who explained themselves as they carried out their acts of terrorism, namely, you are raping our women. Exactly the words that Glenda has quoted here today, heard in the basement of Emanuel AME. Until 2012, for a taste of this society, you could pay a visit to the Redneck Shop and Ku Klux Klan Museum in the town of Lawrence. Now, the Klan is defunct, and I don't want to fearmonger by using its name. Nevertheless, the lingering gases of white supremacist ideology are like pure oxygen in these counties and towns. Today, in South Carolina, white and black society are like, to borrow a phrase from Stephen Jay Gould, two non-overlapping magisteria, two blocks of culture that coexist and do not interact or intersect, or interact only over thin bands of communication. This is because the structural beams of race and caste are the sturdiest in South Carolina. Wealth inequality is most profound, education is most unequally distributed. The so-called black middle class is least active and slowest growing. The private sector is the most overt in its exclusion of black people from employment and from positions of authority within organizations. Charleston is a city that is loath to change. When the shooting took place, I was in Natchez, Mississippi, working on a piece of journalism. I debated whether to go to Charleston and did not, which I now regret. An activist would have gone. I'm not an activist. So instead, I called friends and family. Some of what they said at the time. We coexist, said a black friend of mine yesterday, a member of Emanuel AME. They ignore us for the most part. She means not 40 years ago, but now. A white cousin of mine, that's another culture. You're doing very well if you can understand it. Now, 3 months later, they are saying different things, which I'll get to in a minute. Open a parenthesis here. I want to say two words about memorials. It's useful, I think, speaking about the Confederate flag, to think about a community like a patient in mental health care. Suppose Charleston and the wider society are in therapy. A patient who suffers traumatic experience has a period of shock and loss, and in the blur, a symbol arises which absorbs the pain and allows the patient not to contemplate the trauma. That symbol is called, in psychoanalysis, a screen memory, a screen that masks, like a curtain, the trauma and substitutes for it. A screen that deflects the injury into a symbol, which is supposed to be the solution, which substitutes for the trauma. The flag, I believe, absorbed the energies that might have gone into talk back about such things as economic injustice. The screen memory, in this case, is the flag. It is also, perhaps, the name John C. Calhoun, which I think is a collection point for anguish, a substitution for something else that is more difficult to look at. So 3 months later, they're saying different things, slightly different things. The black woman who said we coexist says the city is trying to do everything. Her name is Sonia Fordham. She's a 45-year-old school teacher. The city is trying to do everything they can to say how genteel everybody has been in the aftermath of the massacre, and how we didn't riot, how we were not Ferguson. Basically, it's kind of true, she says. But just having a conversation is not going to do anything about why the young man killed all those people to begin with. The reason he killed those people was that he had been taught through everything in his childhood that black people are his enemy and we are barbaric. She says furthermore, I don't think this is unusual. I don't think we should not expect this. A lot of black people are used to dealing with atrocities. We're used to atrocities happening to us. The flag came down, and that is wonderful, but it shouldn't have been up there to begin with. Now, white folks speak to you when they see you. But that doesn't have anything to do with jobs. White people are crying, but they don't want us to live next door to them. We speak, but we don't interact. That's a 45-year-old black woman. A 73-year-old white attorney within the political establishment says, his name is Thomas Tisdale. He's a lawyer and longtime ally of the mayor, Joseph Riley, who's been in office for 40 years. Tom Tisdale says, it has been game-changing for the community. What has happened has been one of the most remarkable things I've ever experienced. There's a huge tragedy, and the response is in proportion to the severity of what has happened, the outpouring. And for the first time in my life, the issue of racism is being confronted intentionally by white people. It's as simple as this. The respectful dignity paid to one another on the street is noticeable, and it is a conscious, intentional thing. You see white folks behaving differently towards black folks. It's strange. It's an intentional thing. Racism is not going to go away because some people got shot in church, but something good is rising in proportion to the horrible event, and we are searching for some way to come to terms with the race problem. So those are some reports from the street. And I will pass the microphone to Vesla.
Thank you, our reporter in Charleston. That was great. Vesla.
So thank you for asking me to be here, and I will try to speak through a cold. In these moments, I find it very difficult to act like an academic. And so in responding to the prompts we were given, I want to draw on some of my visceral reactions in the moment and sense to Charleston, but also to Ferguson, and to the many other instances of collective witnessing of black insecurity from early death that I had in the moment and beyond. And the first, let me just begin with an anecdote, and I'm sorry they're taping this because I'm gonna probably anger some people. But I interned way back when I was in college at an outfit called the Southern Poverty Law Center. Some of you likely know it. They're one of the foremost organizations challenging white supremacist violence in the South and white supremacist groups. And I left that summer not feeling well about my experience, to put it lightly. And the reason is that here was this organization that took in probably millions of dollars from individual donors, had a beautiful, beautiful building. And if you went to the third floor of the building, or maybe it was the sixth, I can't now remember, all of the people that staffed the third floor of the building were black. And they were there in menial jobs, opening letter after letter, opening donation envelopes. And passing on the checks to the higher-ups. And you could virtually see almost no black representation in any other higher position in the Southern Poverty Law Center. And so I left feeling like here we have given a microphone to an organization that combats racial violence and white supremacist organizing, and yet we have somehow managed to decouple racial terror from the everyday mundane acts of racial violence by the state or otherwise that occur in black people's lives. We were so seduced. We are so continually seduced by the overt, blatant bigotry of a Dylan Roof and his connection to white supremacist organizations that we fail to see several things, right? We fail to see black inequality right there in our midst. And I'd like to point out several of those things that occurred to me in that moment. The first thing that we fail to see when we focus so heavily on individual bigotry and individualized pathology and illness is that racial animus itself helps to sustain our broader gun culture, helps to sustain the opposition to gun regulation, And here I'd like to point out there's this great study by Alexandra Philindra that finds that one of the biggest predictors of both gun ownership and opposition to the regulation of access to guns is not fear of crime, it's not ideology, it's not adherence to sportsmanship. It's what? It's racial prejudice. It's the single best predictor. And much like Glenda was describing the New South, this is actually a rather new development, that over the course of several decades, a white ideology around support for guns became part of what it means to hold fast to a white identity. Okay. The second thing that I'd like to point out is that the spectrum of racial terror by the state and by non-state actors has been disappeared in this moment. I found it very strange the way we couldn't quite make the link between the twin aspects, right? These are all part of a larger puzzle of black insecurity from early death and predatory violence. We couldn't quite make the link between what was going on in Charleston and what was going on elsewhere across the country. We didn't have the language, right? In one, it's a bigoted, you know, and in fact, I was reading today, I think this was in the Chicago Tribune, an op-ed where they described Dylann Roof and their response to Dylann Roof almost like he was Dennis the Menace, right? And they said, look, this is an aberration, I'm quoting, a deeply disturbed, violent menace. And so one of the things I wanted to raise in this conversation is the twinned aspects of the racial denial of black pain and suffering by the mass public on the one hand, combined with the state's failure to respond to early black death and to protect blacks, black lives, and black bodies from violence by non-state actors. I think those two things go very much together. Another thought I had in the wake of this moment was the way that we ask blacks immediately to engage in massive forgiveness, not massive resistance, massive forgiveness, as though the imperative of repairing our democracy, that democratic repair takes precedence over racial justice or over acknowledging black pain and black anger. The next thing that occurred to me that rises into plain view once we are not seduced by the individual bigotry of a lone wolf is the way that we pathologize black violence, but we individualize, or even disappear, if you believe Khalil Muhammad, white racial violence, and that this country has a very long, sordid tradition of doing that. One need only look at the racialized media coverage in the aftermath and the way Dylann was treated as a suspect, contrasted with the treatment of Michael Brown as he laid there in the street for 4 hours. I wanted to put on the table the legacy of slavery, and I apologize, these are just thoughts that occurred to me. The legacy of slavery that Edward pointed to is very much with us, but it becomes difficult to disentangle, it becomes difficult to name. We all sort of know that it's there, we know that the Confederate flag is a symbol. There's a nice study by Maya Sen, a political scientist, that has found that racial attitudes today, the kinds of attitudes that Dylann Roof harbored, the kinds of socialization of white youth, have everything to do with how vested your jurisdiction was in slavery. So the amount, she finds that the amount, the proportion of the population that was enslaved in 1860 across counties has a discernible effect is one of the biggest predictors of racial attitudes today, of white vote support in presidential elections. Okay. And then finally, so that I don't leave you on a down note, one reason perhaps for optimism. In an earlier book that I wrote called Creating a New Racial Order, my co-authors and I were sort of dismayed to see that among black youth, when you ask black youth, what do you think are the reasons for inequality, racial inequality today? Many of them say, well, it's not racial discrimination, it's lack of individual effort. It's not, blacks not taking personal responsibility seriously. It's blacks not working hard enough. We all have a fair shot. We all believe in the American dream. And we were sort of, I was sort of dismayed to see that, because without a sense, without a larger sense of racial injustice, if you're charging everything off to individual responsibility and individual choices, absent a broader structural context, it becomes very difficult to mount sustained collective action against racial injustice. And that, I think, is changing. I think the collective memories of black youth and white youth coming of age today have been forged in this moment. Black anger has been forged, it has been emboldened to take on things that weren't part of the conversation. And so even though some might read the recent polls saying that black youth really are alienated as being cause for despair, I actually see it as cause for, not celebration, but optimism. That there now is, in this moment, forged a new language and a new collective sense that black youth are too insecure in their basic personhood. Thank you.
Thanks, Vesla. Jelani, you're 3 minutes. I lost control of the clock, folks. All my fault.
Thank you. I want to apologize for my late arrival. I was coming from New York, and I kind of took the idealistic approach to what the traffic was going to be like getting here.
We've all done that.
Yeah. And so I think I took a corner on two wheels getting here, but... there are a couple of things I want to say very briefly. One is that I'm actually coming from Charleston. I flew in from Charleston last night. I was there over the weekend and participated in a town hall discussion. And I just want to kind of relay some of the themes that came out in that conversation. I'll make a couple of points and then kind of go segue into that. But one notable thing that happened on the way back here is that when I was in the airport in Charleston, I was rushing to make my flight. There's an African American, a little bit shorter than me, but also bald and in a suit, and I'm just thinking we could have been almost interchangeable. He's rushing to make his flight as well, and we're going through security. And at some point, he turns just a bit to the side, and I realize that the person in front of me is Senator Tim Scott, the junior senator from the state of South Carolina, and we say the senator that is not running for president from South Carolina. And he was, off to, I presume, Washington, D.C., but it was kind of a notable moment for me that I was coming from this town hall about this instance of racial terrorism, and just moments later, I found myself directly behind someone whose position so closely links to the kind of upsurge of racial terrorism in the state of South Carolina and the advent of black political power in the South following Reconstruction. And it's possible to look at this and impose a narrative of progress upon it, that there is an African-American senator who was present in close proximity to an Indian-American governor of South Carolina who gave a speech about maybe a week and a half or 2 weeks ago to the press club, National Press Club, about herself as a narrative for racial progress in the state of South Carolina, And moreover, there is an image that some future archivist will likely point out of Senator Tim Scott standing next to Governor Nikki Haley at the ceremony at which the Confederate flag was being lowered on the Capitol grounds of South Carolina. Now, what's most fascinating to me about this is that it points to some ways that this could coexist at the same point. There's another kind of notable development we find. Social scientists have noted this for the last several years, that when you poll white people, you find a significant plurality, and in some instances, a small majority, who believe that the primary victims of racial bias and discrimination in the United States currently are white people. And, you know, it's notable that these two things could coexist. And I was there at the Confederate grounds when, you know, there were these rallies to say that the Confederate flag should come down. Excuse me, at the Capitol grounds, whatever, the rallies saying that the Confederate flag should come down. And the only previous time that I'd been at the state capitol, South Carolina, was in 2008 as a group of people rallied supporters to go out and knock on doors for Barack Obama's presidential candidacy. And so all these kind of layers of history overlapped. And because of my two visits to the Capitol grounds, I noted the kind of layout there. And so Nikki Haley, to her credit, said that they would take down the Confederate flag, and the Confederate flag came down. But we should talk about what remains. On the Capitol grounds, there is a monument to Ben Tillman, the Reconstruction-era governor, post-Reconstruction-era governor, who prided himself on having organized lynch mobs. And that monument remains. Just aside from the Tillman monument, there's a monument to J. Marion Sims, who some people will recall as the kind of father of modern gynecology. There is a speculum named for Mr. Dr. Sims. He also was an individual who experimented on black women, on enslaved black women, who used their bodies as proxies for white women as he perfected medical techniques that have now become kind of standard practice in American gynecology. And that monument remains on the Capitol grounds. And so these kind of disparate things point to a current reality that I'm not sure we've quite grasped, which is that racism, which we tended to think of in its classic formations as a impermeable barrier or a kind of racial totalitarianism, now functions as a kind of selectively permeable barrier in which a person like Tim Scott, a person like Nikki Haley could coexist with the reality of a white population in the state that believes itself to be besieged. And more tellingly, the city of Charleston, in which this atrocity took place, which has a very rapidly changing social and demographic landscape for one reason, and that reason being gentrification. And so in the midst of this conversation yesterday, I had a chance to talk with Malcolm Graham, whose sister was killed in Emanuel AME in June by Dylann Roof, presumably by Dylann Roof. And he said that he resented the idea that he should have to grant automatic absolution and forgiveness to Dylann Roof. And he said that he did not believe that his sister's life and forgiveness for the person who was responsible for taking his sister's life was a fair trade for the lowering of a flag. He felt that that belittled his sister's life and her legacy. But he said something else to me I thought that was equally notable, and that he said that Emanuel AME had struggled before, it had seen difficulty before that fateful night in June. And that was because its population was diminishing. Black people are moving out of Charleston. And initially, when I went there, was the first week that this happened. And I was impressed that sometimes the crowds of black people, crowds of people who were there to pay tribute, that African Americans were in the minority. And was like, this is really notable that so many white people have come out to say that they do not, that they stand against what happened here. Then it was pointed out to me that this is simply a reflection of the population of Charleston. There are far more whites in Charleston now than there are blacks, and therefore the group of mourners, not to take anything away from people who came out to make that statement, but demographically it looked the way the city of Charleston looks. And so there's one other thing that I just want to point to that kind of talks about the cyclical nature of this and the context in which Dylan Roof's actions took place. We are at the centennial anniversary of the film Birth of a Nation. I know Jonathan mentioned this, but we have the centennial anniversary of its release this year. Birth of a Nation itself was released 50 years after the end of the Civil War. And when we talk about that film, we typically talk about it as a kind of egregious demonstration of racial theories and racism. It's don't have to look very far to see the kind of overt ideas of racism that D.W. Griffith was trafficking in that film. But I think there's a far more troubling aspect of that film, and one that didn't come fully into focus until recently, and that is the extent to which D.W. Griffith was right. The underlying sentiment of that film was that he proposed that the mutual animus toward black people could be the basis along which white Southerners and white Northerners could reconcile. When we look at the white response, white Northern response to blacks during the Great Migration, you can go back and kind of see images in Detroit of kind of whites-only residences. And we look at the history in American cities that we've been forced to confront in places like Ferguson and Baltimore, and when we look at the language of white nationalism that has come to the fore, being trafficked in by people like Donald Trump in the presidential level candidacy, as well as Dylan Roof in this manifesto that he released, we can see that there is this kind of unifying rhetoric of white nationalism that has transcended region. And I think that is the point that we should be most concerned about, not that this is an isolated instance among a lone wolf individual who was deranged by his contempt for black people, but the fact that he, in some ways, is a litmus test, or he is the finger on the pulse of where white racial sentiment has gone as a national dynamic in the era of Barack Obama.
Wow, thank you. Thank you all to the panel. Terrific presentations. You left out Strom Thurmond.
We didn't get to him.
That's right. He's on the Capitol grounds there, too, right. Like three times the size of life. It's, anyway. I want to ask, probe the panel on two or three questions that have been raised and push them a bit, and then we're going to open it up to you. Two questions in particular. I want us to discuss a little further this question of forgiveness. It's had a huge kind of, at times, very confusing commentary. I remember right after the killings and those families were put on television for whatever reason to face that kid. And pundits were aghast, how can these people do this? And on and on and on it went. And now, and you talking to the young man, was it his sister who was killed?
His sister.
Perfectly understandable response by him. But at the same time, I want to just push this a bit. One thing that sometimes gets forgotten in that those acts by those people is what serious Christians they are. In secular America and in the secular academy sometimes, I hate to be the one to have to say this, but we sometimes don't get that. And that forgiveness, if you look into Christian traditions of forgiveness, is not about the perpetrator. It's about the victim. It's about how they're going to survive. How are they going to cope? And when those women looked into that camera, literally the day after, I mean, what they have, 24 hours to even think on this? I can't explain why they did what they did. But if you really, really understand church people, it becomes understandable that they would do that. And I'm only suggesting that we ought be careful how we judge that. The notion that they were made to do that somehow seems to me questionable. I'd like to get a couple of you at least to reflect on the politics of the flag. I just had a call this morning from someone that many of us know here, Owen Williams, who did his PhD here. Some of you knew Owen. He's now the president of a consortium of 16 southern colleges, places like Washington and Lee and Davidson and many, many others around the South out of Atlanta. He's based out of Atlanta. He does PhD here, that's a long story. But Owen travels all over the South now by car, college after college after college, and he reported to me this morning that he sees far more Confederate flags now than he saw last year, particularly in rural areas, particularly at crossroads, particularly on some restaurants, et cetera, backs of trucks and so forth. And I guess the question I want us to think about, and there's no simple answer for this. I've been asked this so many times, and I end up half the time saying I don't know, is why suddenly did the flag have nowhere it could hide? Politically, nowhere it could hide in the mainstream. What caused that moment? And Glenda, you might pick up that one first because you know Southern politics so well, and it's part of what you wrote about in your piece. Let's take those two questions first. You want to take the flag first? And then we can talk about forgiveness if anybody wants to.
So I think that we've heard some actual political scientists give us some actual figures about gun owning and white supremacy, about white people who think that they are the race that's discriminated against. And I think that we are in an era of rising racial prejudice among white people, particularly in the South, but also in urban northern places. My son's African American. He went south to North Carolina, where we're from, to college. And he said, after Charleston, he wrote to me and some other people and said that Confederate flags were on every hall in the dormitories where he went. This was shocking to me, having left the South to come here 25 years ago. The rising racism is in the face of a post-racial society, in the face of forgiveness from the people who were relatives of the victims of the massacre. And I'm not sure that forgiveness is the safe sort of response to this. I think Dylan Roof's family, I did his genealogy on both sides. His people were Methodist. They weren't slaveholders. They were small farmers in western North Carolina and upper South Carolina. They had names like Temperance. And his grandfather was a judge. But in the last generation, his father was a brawling building contractor, and his mother worked at a bar, and they didn't. There was nothing in that culture for that boy, for Dylan Roof. He had nothing to look forward to. So I think that I would tie rising racism together with lower expectations and kind of a culture of meanness that has permeated our society and that we have to stop or we're going to lose our country.
Great, but politically, why? What happened in that moment? I mean, why did Nikki, I mean, a lot of us may think we know the answer to this. Johnny, you might take, why did Nikki Haley get up so quick and want that flag down?
Well, for a couple of things that there was, we should be bear in mind that this was kind of like the White Citizens Council racism versus the Ku Klux Klan racism. There are people in the business community in South Carolina who for a long time have said, we don't like, bringing investors here, and people look at this flag and they think they were barbarians. There are people from the University of South Carolina who said that they had a difficult time when they were recruiting prospective graduate students, particularly if you're talking about Black American graduate students who might disagree with the Confederate flag flying, but you understand what the kind of genesis of this is. But when they would have Black students from abroad, they would see a Confederate flag and say, I don't feel safe here. And so she wasn't responding simply to the kind of racial polarities that were there in South Carolina. She was making what seemed to be a smart decision, and it also based upon the kind of murmuring about her as a vice presidential candidate, this was expedient for her politically. Now, that notwithstanding, I think that white supremacy is a very, very well-engineered system. And it has managed to jettison its most ineffective parts when necessary in order to maintain the better functioning of the entire organism. I think the absence of a Confederate flag and the presence of incarceration and substandard education and the kind of socioeconomic gaps that we see In some ways, it gave people a false sense of progress. Now, on the matter of forgiveness, I think there's, as cynical as it may sound, I think that it's probably an ambivalent virtue to be morally superior to your enemies. Black people have, for time immemorial, been rewarded with kind of a lauded, we should say, with their rigorous adherence to Christianity. But in the face of people who purportedly were Christians and saw no difficulty in maintaining them their position as slaves, you're going to say, well, you know, as a personal virtue, I'm in no position to judge how someone deals with grief or the spiritual mandates of their religion. I am, however, in a position to make an assessment that politically, forgiveness as a personal virtue is one thing, but forgiveness as a public political act is something entirely different, particularly since we saw just after that the shooting in North Carolina at the recruitment center, or any kind of the number of instances that the United States has dealt with in terms of terrorism, we have not trafficked in the language of forgiveness and moral superiority against people who've done offenses to us.
I want to add one thing to that. Lindsey Graham, we should remember, is running for president, even though it's not obvious. And his website says, has two banners on the top, ready to be commander-in-chief on day one and promoting our values. Now, you don't have to be Einstein to understand the connections with what Dylann Roof thought he was doing and what Lindsey Graham is doing.
And by the way, I just point out, too, that if you dig around on Nikki Haley, I mean, I didn't come here today to trash Nikki Haley, but why not? There's a website that calls itself the Academy Awards of Voter Suppression. And she was, actually, North Carolina got Best Picture, just by a hair over South Carolina, but Nikki Haley got Best Actress. I know this is you know, a parody, but the South Carolina voter ID law is Nikki Haley's creation. She first created it and pushed it through in 2011. It was stricken down by the Holder Justice Department, and then in 2012 was the Shelby case, which wiped out Section 5 of the Voting Rights Act, and immediately she pushed it back through. Only two people in the South Carolina Senate voted against that voter ID law, and one of them was Clementa Pinckney. As soon as I see some Republican, anywhere, but especially one in South Carolina, get up and denounce voter suppression, I'll know that not much has changed after Charleston. At least that's just the way I feel about it. There are many, many other things I'd love to get the panel to address, but I got a feeling the audience is itching to ask questions. So why don't we open it up now? We got microphones. We've occupied you an hour already. You're being spared all my other questions. So who's first? Oh, Steve, of course. And then who's next? Show me some hands. I think it's on.
In all of you see one divine, personal divine question, namely, we all understand the great relationship between slavery and the Civil War. But if you go to places, I was in Boston this year, at least, on the Statehouse, there is no monument for slavery, a zillion monuments for the Civil War. And if you talk to many people, not necessarily Boston, but outside of Boston, people will say, oh, it has nothing to do with slavery, it's the Civil War that we're commemorating. I think that's an issue. I think David's question about the Christian really goes to the heart of a large part of what's happening in this country. And I know that may be so far off that you may not want to get into it, but I think that that's a real understanding of the differences and divides between different groups.
Do you want us to address monuments as a question? Like, why are they?
Yeah, in other words, how does one talk to someone who says it's not slavery, it's celebrating the Civil War?
You give them a mini lecture as long as you can hold them in the same place. You ask them to try to explain why the war would have happened. about it. And if you don't get anywhere, then so be it, which is often the case. The problem is if you're doing this at a monument with somebody, that's a problem. The classroom is another matter. You know, look, the broader debate, and anyone else can pick this up, but in my now 20-some years of studying Civil War memory and memorialization and all that goes with it, there's never been a moment like this. When suddenly there's a political space because of the Charleston murders that there's a critique of civil, there's a critique of Confederate monuments like there had never been so open. There's always been a critique. There's always been little protests here and there. There's always been little efforts to get rid of the Confederate forest stuff and so forth. And there's a guy in Texas who's been trying for 25 years to tear down Robert E. Lee monuments. He hasn't gotten one of them yet. But there's a political space suddenly where this is up for grabs in cities and city councils and state legislatures. No one can predict where that's necessarily going, except it's interesting. It may just fizzle out and die out, like the so-called bipartisan committee that John Boehner appointed in Congress, which is supposed to look at the number of Confederates memorialized inside the U.S. Capitol. I don't think that committee's ever reported, so far as I know. I hope perhaps someday it might. Edward, do you want to take that up, memorials?
Just
monuments?
For a moment, just to ask a devil's advocate question, but what kind of difference would it make if we suddenly removed all the Confederate monuments? The Confederate monuments, of which there are thousands, were part of a wave of revisionist ideology during the Lost Cause phase of Civil War memory. Mm-hmm. And now if we have a revision to the revision and we suddenly remove them all, what difference would it make? In Montgomery, Alabama, which is the first capital of the Confederacy before it was moved to Richmond, there are 59 Confederate monuments. In Richmond, there is a street called Monument Avenue, which tries to place one at every intersection. And with the only interruption being a statue of Arthur Ashe, the black tennis player, what kinds of energies would be absorbed by tinkering with the concrete memorialization of the Civil War? I think it would be an enormous expenditure of resources and political energy to do something like that.
I agree, and I think it would be a distraction, and I hope none of them are taken down. But I just thought I'd raise the question. It's suddenly politically appropriate in some places, in some city councils, to get bothered about their Robert E. Lee monument. I wish they were bothered about voter ID and economic inequality,
well,
but that's...
Let me...
Yeah. Go ahead.
I disagree
All
with
right.
you. I've
All
always, and I just changed my mind on this issue this summer, I've always thought that what you should do with these racist commemorations is show exactly what the story was. Julia Adams and I talked about doing a seminar, college seminar, on Calhoun slaves and then memorializing the people who were enslaved to Calhoun. But I think that in this conversation, we have to be really clear about what's going on. The Civil War happened. It's going to be commemorated. But certain leaders, for example, John C. Calhoun or Ben Tillman, who founded the Red Shirts, John C. Calhoun, who single-handedly tried to advocate a philosophy to break up our nation, these commemorations have never been refuted by commemorations to the people they tortured, the people they killed. The Civil Rights Museum in Greensboro, where I grew up, has a wall of all the people who were killed fighting for racial justice in the Civil Rights Movement. And when my son went through, he looked up, he said, well, the murderers are still alive, aren't they? Well, indeed they are. So I've waited for Yale for 20 years to do something about John C. Calhoun as a college. I've taken it with a grain of salt. I've thought, you know, this can't be so bad. But actually, it is bad. And actually, it does drive students to feel hurt and cut to to the core when they have to see this. Yale is a private institution. It has chosen to commemorate John C. Calhoun. It can choose not to. I've waited for 20 years on this campus, and as Thurgood Marshall said, somebody asked him in 1955, well, don't you think that desegregation should be gradual? And he said, I believe in gradualism. 90-odd years is pretty damn gradual.
Jonathan, you want to say anything about that? You don't have to.
There's lots of things I can say about this. And I certainly was shaken, disillusioned, brokenhearted. I mean, with example after example, this is not even thinking about Charleston. It's like, again? Really? Again? And knowing as a historian, this is not a new story, but that it's being caught again and again. What are the odds by happenstance someone's going to have a camera right there when this thing is happening? This means it's happening even that much more often that's not being captured on film. So I certainly understand Glenda's change of heart or change of mind about this, about the naming of Calhoun specifically. I'm actually going to, and I've gone on record with the Yale Alumni Magazine, I don't know how many years ago now, 4 or 5 years ago, that the name should not be changed because Yale would do a terrible decision. I don't like the man at all. I think it's ridiculous. But that Yale did make this decision. And this becomes a vehicle for us to keep talking about it. Now, whether we actually do talk about it is a different issue altogether. Okay, I concede that point. And I certainly could have been done more when I was a master. But I worry about self-satisfaction. That if you take down the flag this is now repeating what people said, I'll be very quick. If you take down the flag in South Carolina, aside from making somebody potentially electable to a different office or appointable, have you created a job? No, you've actually done everything to prevent the need to create a job or provide health care or to address economic inequality. Your self-satisfaction, in this age of Facebook-like, self-satisfaction is a real scary phenomenon. I feel the same way about the naming of Calhoun College. I have felt the same way about that for fear of self-satisfaction and amnesia. I'm actually not going to say more than that because I'm the dean of the college. And no. In this moment, out of respect for, I think, a very important conversation that's going to continue happening for a while longer. But you will hear from me and the president later on in this school year. So I'm going to step one step shy of a final declaration on that point.
Can I add something really,
Johnny,
quick, really quickly to this? Just as a quick anecdote. I lived in Atlanta for 10 years, and just on the outskirts of Atlanta is Stone Mountain Park. If anyone's familiar with Stone Mountain Park, it is basically a Confederate theme park. There are this huge mountain, right? It's like this huge stone slab. The Klan would have these rallies, would burn crosses, on atop of it, the resurgent, second Klan. There's Stonewall Jackson, Jefferson Davis, and Robert E. Lee, who are literally etched into the face of this mountain. And at night and during the summer, they do these kind of laser light shows. And the streets are named in all these Confederate kind of places. And I didn't know anything about this when I first moved to Atlanta, and some people said they were going to Stone Mountain Park, and I went, and I was horrified. And these were African Americans who were there, and I was looking around, and I saw that this park was full of black people. And I thought that I was in despair, because I said, why are we here? We should be as far from this place as possible. And then a few years went by, and a friend of mine pointed out to me that the mayor of Stone Mountain is a suburb, it has an affluent black population. The mayor of Stone Mountain is African American, and he lives in a house that was formerly owned by a grand dragon of the Ku Klux Klan. And at that point, I really started going to Stone Mountain as often as I could. A friend and I would hike, literally every Saturday we would go hike up Stone Mountain. This is because of my love of irony. So because I was like, at first I felt they should take these images of these Confederate kind of avatars down. You know, like they should be sandblasted off. And then I came to appreciate the images of Lee and Jackson, you know, Davis, overlooking affluent black people enjoying themselves. And I felt like this was the best way of responding
to it. It's torture for them.
Right.
Quick anecdote, too. Some of you who heard the master's tea at Calhoun a week ago or 2 weeks ago or whenever it was, I asked all the students to think about where their line would be drawn about memorialization. You know, is it in flags? Is it in memorials, monuments, names? Where are you going to draw your line? And I realized this summer I have a line. Glenda, I have a line. And it came out of a reporter one day. I'm on the phone again. It's Charleston flags, yada, yada, yada. And he asked me about the Congress having this row about the Confederates in the U.S. Capitol. And I suddenly realized, I knew they were there, but I suddenly realized that's a line for me. Jefferson Davis and Robert E. Lee in Statuary Hall. That's the United States Capitol. They fought to destroy the United States. I know why they're there. I know they can't be taken out because they were put there by their states, but that's a line. And everyone has got to figure out their own line, whether it's a name, whether it's public, whether it's private. It's up to you. Yes, sir, over here, and then in the middle here. And then.
I have another question as well. I'd be interested in pushing the panel on what they think their, what the end goal of living with these structures and these spaces is, because it's apparent that they can't all be removed. It's one thing to lower a flag, but it's quite another to topple up a statue of Robert Lee. You can take the name off of Calvin College, but it's quite another thing to chisel them off of Harkin's Tower, or to remove the 54 names of Confederate soldiers that are in the interior of the rotunda across the street. And even when you do that, there are signs and symbols, physical and otherwise, that remind us of this unpleasant past. So if we're consigned to live in a world surrounded by these biased symbols, how is it that we can incorporate them usefully into educational programming or something like that? Is it possible to look out to other countries that can force deal with this as well? Germany certainly comes to mind. I'm curious to know what a hard and fast solution to this is possible.
Did you say you want a hard and fast solution?
What is the condition for such? Because it's
not hard and fast.
I have a few thoughts on that. I don't know the answer to how do we include and make these symbols do work for us if they are to remain. But one thing that has struck me is not just the presence of these symbols, but the absence of any serious effort to gather overtime data on racial violence. Right. So on the one hand, we have these ever-present, very in-your-face symbols, not just in the South, but in the North as well. And on the other hand, we don't actually have, if you wanted to actually get statistics on who has died over time, who has done the maiming, what has happened, there's very little actually on that. And you know, one of my colleagues in political science, Melissa Nobles, began a project years ago to start to collect, not as a project of commemoration, but of just fact-finding, every instance of racial violence across our history. And she began uncovering aspects of our history that people didn't know, like the fact that in some areas of the South, bus drivers were deputized to shoot to kill blacks who violated racial mores, that they often rode their buses with, you know, fully armed, and would often, more often than we have really, you know, sort of taken into our national imagination and our national narrative, perpetrate violence. And so I think the conversation, for me, needs to move not just to what do we do with these lingering symbols of white supremacy, but then also how do we commemorate black suffering and black death? How do we actually, you know, I mean, yeah, we have crowdsourced instances of police violence against blacks, but we don't actually have a good national understanding of how often And who were the perpetrators? What were the media framings around this instance? What happened to the perpetrators? What are their names? We don't have that. So I think that the conversation needs to not just be about dismantling, but also about constructing. And you know, to jump back to this gentleman's question, you know, I don't think that you can decouple the support, or you know, the new support among political elites in the South for dismantling, you know, for pulling down the flag, and the bigger step, which is, what do we owe? What do we as a nation owe communities that have endured early death and suffering? And I went back to an old set of social surveys done by Michael Dawson far before Charleston massacre. And the social survey asked national, you know, representative sample of whites, do you support an apology for slavery? Do you support any kind of reparations? And then actually asked people very specific instances of racial violence. Do you support some, you know, measure of reparations for blacks who were the descendants of the people killed in the Tulsa race riots? And you wouldn't believe the amount of opposition to basic, you know, a basic apology, right? A basic level of remuneration for the victims and their progeny and their descendants. And I don't think that that opposition is unrelated to support for symbols like the flag.
Yeah, think imaginatively. Maybe in 5 years, 10 years, the Congress will approve a monument on the National Mall to the very people victimized as Vesla. I mean, think imaginatively about memorialization is one way to think about this, as opposed to tearing down old ones, you think about new ones.
I want to respond to him, because he asked a very serious question. Do you take the 54 names off of the Confederates? And, you know, we come from a place where you couldn't have any buildings named if you weren't going to name them for white supremacists. And my position on, because they controlled everything and all the buildings are named for them, my position on this is that we have a, this is a complex problem, but it's not that complex. The 54 Yalies who died in the Civil War are in a certain place in Woolsey Hall. They gave a sacrifice. They were Yalies. They deserved to be there. They thought they were doing their duty. John C. Calhoun in a residence hall where people live and people every day have to face him, to me, is a very different thing, a very different thing. And I don't think this is, you know, physics. I think we can figure this out piece by piece. I don't think it should be ideologically driven, out with all the white bastards. I do think that we have enough sense to know when someone was a tyrant and we don't want to honor him.
Yes, ma'am. I'm going to add one very, very short. David, you need to put that mic in front of you. Your mic etiquette is terrible.
I know.
But very, very quickly, one thing that wasn't taken up. Stop talking. One thing that we did, I want to address one thing that you asked very early on, and that's about what I took it to understand is local resources. Like, it's one thing to have to be carved into stone, or, you know, whether it's a representation of your face or your name or something, and instead of, perhaps as an option, instead of changing the name of a college, and I'm not talking just about Calhoun, Morse was a son of a gun as well, right? And named in 64, for goodness sakes. Calhoun's just easier. There are, instead of changing a name, why don't we increase resources on the campus to talk about these kinds of things that address structural intellectual inequalities in terms of what's a serious problem, what's a good question to ask, how can we improve access for people who want to ask these kinds of questions, regardless of what color they are. I don't care. What about the creation of institutes that are going to study these kinds of questions? That's a response that's real as well. I asked the question myself.
Yes, ma'am, in the middle row.
Thank you. The first thought that comes to my mind is complacency.
We'll take that as a question. Okay. Well, we're trying to make suggestions. Let's move. We got some other. Yeah, right in the almost back row. Yeah. Hey.
Can I just say really quickly, there are two things. One is that, you know, James Baldwin said that he thought that the only authentic Christianity in America was the Christianity of the slave, because that was the person who believed in the moral redemption and didn't seek, they used their religion as a means to justify the exploitation of someone else. And I think that in some ways that carries forward. Because when we talk about race and we talk about racism, the almost kind of instinctive reflex is to begin pointing to black people's shortcomings, which is why when we talk about state violence, we think we make this completely reflexive cliche about, well, what about black on black violence, as if those two things have any kind of relation. But what we're actually trying to do is undermine the moral claim. And so, we're talking, and one of the things that makes me so ambivalent about this idea of forgiveness is that we're lauding black people for being forgiving of the offenses committed against us in a country that doesn't forgive black people for not having recovered from the things that have been done from us to us quickly enough on their timetable. And so we point to a so-called achievement gap and then extrapolate from that to say that there's something wrong with black children, as if history didn't happen,
right.
You know, or, you know, when we talk, if I can talk personally, my father had a third grade education in a segregated town in Georgia, and I got my doctorate from Rutgers University down the street. It would almost seem as if we could say in that one generation, no harm, no foul. It's like, well, you didn't turn out too bad. And I think that this is the problem. And I also don't think that this problem is unrelated to the other structural concerns that we've talked about. When we are forced to deal with race in public, we deal with it most commonly on the level of individual sentiment, and the kind of Rodney King phrasing, can't we all just get along? But it's not a matter of individual sentiment, or some of my close friends are white, some of my best friends are white, I could say, right? It's not simply that, it's the allocation of resources and the way in which this has been replicated. Places like this, not to single this institution out, but there are lots of other places in this country that exist to replicate the empowerment of a certain set of people. As America has become perhaps more conscious of these things, we take a small number of people from other groups and we say, okay, you can be part of this class as well. But generally speaking, the system works out the way that it's supposed to. Whether we like white people, whether you have a black friend, whether we have Asian friends, or we all get together and have kind of our personal lives look like the college brochure where they show everyone happy and kind of eating pizza together and we think that this is great, but the fact of the matter is our individual life outcomes don't mirror that, and that's not accidental, which is why it becomes frustrating, almost the basis for pessimism to say, not can't we all get along, but what really are people prepared to give up in pursuit of equality?
There's a question over here. Wendell.
Thank you. I can't help but ask this question because, while I'm new to it,
Is that mic on?
Speak into it.
Speak right into it, Manuel. Okay.
I can't help but ask this question because all the news that a couple of people have asked me to is all the questions. And so this is something I've also been grappling with since I got my teens when I started to learn about the ways of the world. Why is race and white supremacy so attractive in this country, especially in this country? I have friends across the pond in Germany, and some of them are white, some of them are conservative. You know, they have reticence about immigration, they have reticence about integration mixing, et cetera. But they find it absolutely repulsive when they see images of swastika. I mean, it's also criminal there in German society. We venerate the most misanthropic symbols in this country, whether it's stars and bars, Confederate generals, Confederate soldiers, what have you. Why is this so attractive in this country, in this issue?
Oh, simply put, and others can take it because it is has al- is and always has been so useful.
You mentioned Germany. Germany went through a kind of re-education process after 1945 that purged and revised the national memory, which is a process that our country never went through. One comment I wanted to add about screen memories and forgiveness. I'm not an expert on the black church, but if you look at all the denominations, African Methodist Episcopal, Church of Christ, Holiness, Baptist, inside those denominations, there is a culture of sacrifice, which goes right back to slavery. Where a kind of Christianity that was based on martyrdom was allowed to flourish. And it persists to the present day. I think everyone in the country outside of the Deep South was startled by the public acts of forgiveness made by the women whose relatives were killed, but that religion of martyrdom and sacrifice is very much alive in many parishes and denominations among tens of millions of people.
Any others want to take this question up? It's a huge question, Wendell, and it's a great question. It requires us to kind of recite some of the markers of the history of white supremacy. I'll just throw in one idea, and then I want others to address this. After the war, Frederick Douglass was fond of saying, and he did it all kinds of ways and all kinds of places, that slavery in America never died honestly. And what he meant by that was that it died in great, massive violence and resistance. It wasn't just, you know, written out of history with an edict like it was in Russia, although there were a lot of rebellions in Russia. British Empire legislated it. It never died honestly. You have to begin with that slavery ended in massive violence. And then you begin to realize how useful white supremacy was and how much more highly developed it became after slavery to control a burgeoning population of former slaves. That's simplistic. But, you know, we talk all the time about the lost cause and lost cause tradition, and Calhoun Calhoun's a kind of a founder of it even before it existed. But the lost cause became a victory narrative. It wasn't about loss at all by the turn of the 20th century. And it became a national victory narrative, a victory over Reconstruction. And when you can begin to see how that took hold on the ground in granular ways, you can begin to see how white supremacy became this unquestioned set of assumptions. It was a set of beliefs in search of a history. And they found it. So, you know, I mean, you know all this. So. Others?
I just want to say that we have the most competitive nation in the world, and we have a theory of government that does not posit the health and well-being of its citizens first. So that kind of competition means that we little rats down on the floor are also competing with one another. And I don't think that our government in any form, I don't think we have the will in this country to provide a social democracy that's going to look after each individual. And I think individuals are then pitted against one another over resources. And that's always going to cause racism.
It's a very quick point. If you go to the Red Army Museum in Moscow, which is an amazing museum, it shows the history of the Soviet military, the Russian military that preceded it, and everything is mounted in these very painstakingly. It's a beautiful, beautiful museum. And then when you get to the part of the museum about World War II, there is an entire room full of Nazi materials, some of which were seized at the end of the war. And all that material is not mounted, but it's on the floor. And there's a kind of barrier around it so people know that this is not something that's under construction, is not temporarily there, this is where it is housed. And so I don't think that we should ignore the extent to which the Nazi version of white supremacy is an international problem for Germany in a way that American racism, particularly in the South, was a regional problem in one country. And that Germany's kind of re-entry into world affairs has been premised upon this denunciation of what Nazism was. As a matter of fact, on the annual May 9th celebrations they have to recognize the end of the war, on not every year, but occasionally Angela Merkel comes, they have, kind of the heads of European states, they come, they commemorate the end of the war in Europe, and each year Germany does this act of contrition, still. And so I think that that's part of it. That's one of the dynamics that is not only useful here, but it's a liability there. And the other thing that I would say is to be mindful that there is still a neo-Nazi population both in Germany and in Russia that find those symbols to be very important. And groups of people who internationally kind of see the Confederate flag and the Nazi flag as not something to be ashamed of, but as a kind of common bond in international white nationalism.
And no foreign power ever occupied us and forced us to face our past, like was done to Germany. Shall we take one more, and then we're going to conclude? One more, right here. We think we got it. Can you put that in a question? Oh, okay, fine. I think you're right. There's no question that slavery is rooted in capitalism, and and Charleston was the entrepot, to say the least. By the way, the same Mayor Joe Riley that Edward mentioned, who's been mayor of that city for 40 years, an amazing man, by the way. Yale should give him an honorary degree. Is trying to build the International Slave Trade Museum at Gadsden's Wharf in Charleston. He needs about $20 million more to make it happen. But before that 80-year-old man dies, he's going to make that happen. He's been trying to do it for decades. This has been an attempt to do what Jon Stewart couldn't do on The Daily Show the night of these murders. Do you remember that night? Mm-hmm. Stewart took the air and said, I have nothing for you. I don't know what to say. All I have is sadness. I'm looking into an abyss. If you go back and look at that episode, it's just one of those moments. He had nothing to say. So we're trying, you know, to start a dialogue about these kinds of issues, whether it's in the wake of Charleston or in the wake of any 10 other of these events we can point to try to give us markers from the past that help us live in the present. Please join me in thanking this amazing panel for taking on this task.